everyone. My name is Haoyi, and this presentation is going to be a hands-on tutorial to walk you through what it's like getting started with Scala.js. So, the agenda for today, first I'll intro what Scala.js is about. I'll go through the three main things that people tend to use Scala.js to do, and then we'll wrap up. So, first, about Scala.js, I'll go through the who, what, where, when, why. So, who am I? My name's Haoyi. I work at Dropbox during the day. I write lots of legacy CoffeeScript, Python, and Bash scripts. So if any of you want to come talk to me about what it's like refactoring a 80,000 line of code, legacy CoffeeScript code base, you can come hang out after the presentation. So I work on this Scala.js stuff in my free time. We don't use much Scala at Dropbox. I think we have maybe 2,000 lines in some internal tools I wrote. And most of the work in Scala.js is done by these two guys. So Sebastian and Tobias have done the bulk of the work. I have a few commits I managed to sneak in there a few months ago, but they are the ones who really made Scala.js what it is today. So what is Scala.js? Scala.js is a Scala to JavaScript compiler. The idea is you can take a Scala source code, compile it into equivalent executable JavaScript, and run it in the web browser. So in terms of performance, it's somewhat slower than raw JavaScript. It is significantly slower than Scala on a JVM. People often underestimate how fast the JVM is. People say, oh, Node.js is evented and really fast. But actually, it's not. The JVM is actually really pretty fast. But despite being slower than the JVM and slower than raw JavaScript, Scala.js is quite a lot faster than the Python that I write day to day, so it's not terrible. And executables it produces, it'll produce a myprogram.js file at the end, tend to range about 150 for a Hello World application to about 400 kilobytes for a large application using lots of libraries. So this is before gzip, and it's not small, but neither is it huge or massive. It's okay size. Especially on the lower end, most of the size is Scala's bloated collections library. So, whoops. Okay, so here is what Scala.js does to a small application. So this is a main method. It defines a variable. It has a while loop that does some useless stuff. And it prints it out. At the end, this should print out 1,000 to the console. Scala.js takes this code and turns it into something that looks like this. So your Scala-style method definition is now a JavaScript prototype assign equals function. That's how you do methods in JavaScript, at least canonically. Variables are variables. While loops are while loops. The implicit extension method, string.toInt, which is actually materializes a bunch of wrappers that you call toInt on, have all been materialized in the source code. So it's not actually string.toInt. It's actually string ops predef.augment string.toInt. And you can see it all present in the JavaScript. Other things of note, similarly, all the methods that you import are now fully qualified. So println has become predef.println. The method names are munged with the types that they take and return. So println takes in an object and returns void. Main returns void, doesn't take anything. So this is to make Java style overloading work. Last thing to take note of here is that what was previously Scala integer addition has now become JavaScript numeric addition modulo zero. So this is a little trick that we use in order to make sure that the JavaScript addition, which is actually double precision floating point addition, behaves identically to Scala's 32-bit integer addition while still maintaining performance. So this is kind of big and bloated and really ugly. But what's important is that it's pretty straightforward and easy to understand, and especially easy for computers to understand, such that when we crunch this through the Google Clojure compiler, we get code that looks like this. So all the method names have been crunched really short, all the class names have been really short. It's way more concise and probably much harder to read. The print line has been inlined. This gray blob here is an inlines internal of the print line function that the Google Clojure compiler decided to inline for us. Why? I don't know. The Google Clojure compiler is an open source tool that does a lot of magic to make your JavaScript small. And there are a lot of smart people working on it, so you can trust that it will do the right thing. So this is kind of what the compilation pipeline looks like. Hope it gives you an idea of what Scala.js tends to do with your source code. So where can you find Scala.js? We have a website. So it's over here. It looks quite pretty. We have a GitHub page where the compiler lives. We have a Google group. And we have a Fiddle. So like JS Fiddle, this is an online interpreter which lets you run Scala.js code. So for example, here's a small example which print, make some sequences, which you can't really, a bit hard to see, but make some sequences and print out some results. Not, yes? The compiler is running on a server. We have not managed to compile the compiler to JavaScript yet. Yeah, so we have a bunch of things in JavaScript, including a standard library, but not the compiler. So that's work in progress. So this is all running on a remote server. I have a compilation server running on EC2. Here's a more interesting example, which actually shows you you can do JavaScript things like talking to a canvas in Scala. You can change these things. I'm going to make this white. I'm going to make this cyan. I'm going to make this pink. Why not? My compilation server seems to not be responding, so it's not actually recompiling. So, oh well, let's skip that for now. Maybe it'll start responding later. So, okay, back to the presentation. Let's pretend that worked. So, another way of looking at the question of where is where can you run Scala.js? And the answer is you can run Scala.js anywhere you can run JavaScript. So, this is not just websites. You can make Tay websites with Scala.js, such as this one. I'm not sure. Redirect. Okay, well, never mind. You can make Tay websites with Scala.js. You can also make Node.js modules. You can also make Chrome extensions. You can do obscure things like someone made the Autodesk Fusion plugin. Oh, that's you? Okay, cool. So these plugins are written in JavaScript. Scala.js compiles to JavaScript. Therefore, I can write them in Scala, which is kind of cute. So this is not just websites. And more importantly, this is not just a JVM. So you can run Scala.js. You can run Scala code anywhere JavaScript code can run. If someone tomorrow comes up with a hipster new microcontroller, which only runs JavaScript because that's how you make things web scale, then you can definitely run your Scala code on a new microcontroller and have a web scale Scala application. So it finally loaded. Here's a Play application set up with Scala.js if you want to try it out. And I'm not sure if he has a link to the example here. He doesn't. But if you download it and run SBT, it will work. So Scala.js was announced last June, well, previous June. I got involved in September after watching Sebastian's video online, his Scala Days presentation. We released version 0.1, which is the first stable version, in December. And right now we're working towards a 1.0. So a lot of stuff has happened in that meantime. But I'm going to gloss over that because that's all past. And I'm going to show you what it's like now. So the last question would be, why Scala.js? And the basic problem, at least I think, that JavaScript is not a very good language. So a very smart person who invented JavaScript has decided that the good parts of JavaScript are about a quarter of an inch thick, and the entire JavaScript spec is about 2 inches thick. So that makes JavaScript about 1/8 of the language good parts in terms of thickness. So this was a while ago, and if we fast forward to today, the same person is saying that now even more parts of JavaScript have been declared ungood, or even double plus ungood. So even new is not working anymore. Let's not use that. Let's not use object create. I know this is object-oriented language. Let's stop using this. Let's stop using null. I gave you guys falsiness. Let's stop using it. That was a bad idea. So by this point, we see JavaScript's about 10% good. And by this point, you see JavaScript's maybe 4 or 5% good. And the other 95 to 96% is just out there to get you and crash your website in production. So one solution for this is you want to try writing a language that works within the 4 or 5% of good JavaScript and enforces you don't step outside. So Scala.js is not the first group to try this. There's a whole bunch of them. Some like Google Web Toolkit are old stalwarts that have been around for a while and are kind of clunky but well-known. Others like CoffeeScript, which is what I write at Dropbox, is a very thin veneer that solves a lot of superficial problems, very effectively solving these superficial problems while leaving the deeper problems alone and not fixing them. Others like Elm or OpaLang are meant to change the way people do web development forever, and so far haven't. And to this mix, we add Scala.js. So Scala.js is our take on how to change web development forever. We also so far haven't, but there is hope. So the basic problem we're trying to solve is that JavaScript isn't good for a variety of reasons, and Scala fixes a bunch of these reasons. So Scala's not 100% good. We have Scala-XML. We have Scala-parser-combinators. We have all the can-build-from rubbish in the standard library. But nevertheless, if you count the good parts of Scala, I would say maybe 70 to 80% of Scala is good parts, which is a lot more than the 4 to 5% of JavaScript that is good parts. So that's why you would like to use Scala.js in theory. So for the first demo, we are going to talk about interactive web pages. interactive web pages are the main thing people use with JavaScript. Use JavaScript for, you can't run anything but JavaScript on the web unless you use Flash, and Flash is more or less dying right now. So let's talk about how to make interactive web pages using Scala.js. So I don't know if you guys can read this. We are going to start from the template application, github.com/lihaoyi/workbench-example-application. So those of you who have laptops, I want to remember this for later, you can take note. If you Google Workbench example app, you'll also get it. So before, let's go to live coding now. I have cloned this earlier. This is a small Scala.js application. Let me kick it off in the browser. So I'm going to say every time I change the code, which is what tilde does, run the fast optimization, which is relatively quick but does not crunch it down all the way and also does not take forever, so we can run it interactively and constantly iterate on the website. If you look at the code, I am defining a case class. I am defining an object with a main method. A bunch of code in here. I'm defining some variables, some helpers. Every time I call the run method, it does 10 iterations of some algorithm that sets the color of the renderer and draws a one by one rectangle. So x is p.x, y is p.y, w and h are both one on the canvas. So this, you don't know what this does, I will show you. So if we go now to localhost index dev, this draws a Sierpinski triangle. So this is a kind of neat thing. You can probably ignore these things because these are just a source maps not being found. So I've set this up such that the log spam goes to the browser. So if I change it, you can see SBT recompiling here. Just saves me flipping back to the console. And the browser updates on its own. So no hands. So come on, save. Okay, why is it not saving? Okay, anyway. So for now, the only thing unusual about this application is that we have these JS export things, which are the way you tell Scala.js, hey, these methods and objects are going to be available from JavaScript. So like Java and like JavaScript, Scala.js applications need to have an entry point. They don't just run top to bottom and evaluating every statement along the way. So this is how you do that. This takes a dom.html canvas element, which is a JavaScript type that is defined in JavaScript. So it's this fellow. It is not a Scala type, it's not defined by us. We just have a facade to it to let you use it. And other things that are interesting, sometimes we need to cast things before we can call methods on them, because in JavaScript you get back a thing of uncertain type and you can just call whatever you want. In Scala, it won't let you do that. So in this case, since I know I'm passing in 2D as a string, I'm getting back a canvas rendering context 2D, which is again a JavaScript type, as a result. So let's see if I can make the reloading work. So gray, yes, and it should reload. It starts off kind of slow because the Scala compiler is very slow, and the Scala.js compiler makes it even slower. But with incremental compilation and with a warmed up JVM, it'll become fast in a minute. So other than this code, which is what's drawing the Sierpinski triangle, let's look at the project layout. This looks like a normal SBT project. I have a git ignore. I have a build SBT. First thing I'll look at is I have this index.dev.html page, which is what I'm going to in the browser, index.dev.html up here. And Scala.js applications in this case runs in a web page, so I'm providing a HTML web page for it to run. It is a very boring web page. Body, it has one canvas, which I hard-coded the width and height. Here I am including the Scala.js output blind executable. For now, it's called example fast optimize.js. This is the little daemon that's forwarding all the log spam to the browser. And this is what kicks off the Scala.js application. I am calling Scala.js example dot main, and I'm passing in the canvas, which I'm getting as document.getElementById. So this is what's calling this object, this method. So that's how the HTML page works. If you look at the SBT config, let's look at the plugins I'm using. I'm using the Scala.js plugin, version 0.5.5, that's latest. And I'm using this workbench thing, which is what forwards a log spam to the browser. Lastly, let's look at the main build file. So settings from the plugins, we have SBT boilerplate. We have one library called Scala.js DOM, which is what provides us the nice, sorry, what provides us a nice statically typed DOM API, so we can call, for example, DOM.alert in a statically typed manner. So if you run that, boom, hello. Let's get rid of that, because it's kind of annoying. And we have some boilerplate to tell the Workbench plugin how to reload the page, because I made it reload automatically. So that said and done, let's look at the output file. So if you look at network tab, go away, why didn't you recompile? Okay, now he's recompiled. If you look at the network tab, you'll see that example faststop.js is now 844 kilobytes, which you can see here as well in my target folder. So it takes a while for IntelliJ to open a megabyte of JavaScript, but if we pull it out and we look for the code, most of this is a standard library, which I said is kind of fat, but this code on the right corresponds to roughly this code on the left. So as I told you earlier, it's kind of bloated. All the methods have their names mangled with the type signatures, but nevertheless, it's relatively straightforward. It's not easy to follow, but you can kind of see what's happening. So count is zero. I don't know what this terminal is. I don't know what this step is. I think this is the inline. I think that's the inline part of the for comprehension. Scala.js inlines for loops on ranges, so that's kind of nice. So you can see now my inline for loop has now become a while loop because Scala.js has optimized it, which does that. And here you're seeing I'm calling fill style and fill rect equals this huge monstrosity, which is what happens when you do string interpolation in Scala. So that's more or less what it looks like after fast optimization. Let's take a moment and see what it looks like after full optimization. I'm going to change it to full optimize. And this will take a moment. It takes a moment longer than fast optimization because the Google Closure Compiler does a lot more optimizations. They're not better or worse, it's just more. So direct optimizing to example opt.js. So now if I change the page to instead load example opt.js. Come on, give me back the console. Let's see. So, and we refresh the page, we will see that we now have example opt.js, which is 140 kilobytes. So this is why I told you that it's much smaller after you crunch it down. It's not tiny, so Closure script code comes down to about 60 kilobytes, and Pure script, which is a Haskell dialect, goes down to about 20 kilobytes. The standard library is kind of bloated, so even after dead code elimination and optimization, we still get about 140 kilobytes. So if you look at the code for the fully optimized version, it looks like that. So you probably don't want to read this. Scala.js example app. So here's the class name. I can't read any of the rest. But you just have to have faith in that the people at Google working on Closure Compiler would not break your code if you follow their rules. And we are following their rules, so there's a bunch of smart people that hopefully will not break your code. At the same time, making it run faster. As you can see, it behaves identically in the browser. So let's take a moment and look at how we would publish such an application. So I'm going to open up Finder, because that's what you do. And at least to a first approximation, I go here, I take this whole thing, I copy and paste it to my Dropbox public folder, replace, go, just stomp over the old thing. And now I can go to the public folder, go to the HTML page, open it, and here you go. It's just a flat file which references JavaScript. So as a first approximation, Scala.js projects are just JavaScript files. There's nothing special about them. If I copy a public link, I believe it should work on the internet. Unfortunately, my Dropbox client seems to be borked. So let's go to dropbox.com, and let's copy the public link there. So public folder, Scala 2.11, index dev, copy public link. Yes, I want to copy it. There you go, on the internet. If any of you want to copy 799.7532/classes, index dev, Scala 2.11, you'll see this is now on the internet. So this is more or less what you can do with a Scala.js application. It's kind of cute. It's a lot easier to share your interactive visualizations with your friends. Like if I tell my friend, here's a jar file, please run it. They'll be like, what's a jar file? Why is it asking me to upgrade my Java? And why is Java installing the ask toolbar when it upgrades? On the other hand, with Scala.js, I can send them a link to my Dropbox public folder and I have a website with a pretty visualization. I can mail them the HTML and JavaScript, which comes up to about 200 kilobytes. It's perfectly reasonable. So enough talking. Let's go back to the original thing. Let's turn it back to dev mode so it working will be faster. And let's turn this into an interactive website. Some of you guys may have seen my previous presentations where I turned into a game. I've already made a game, so I will not make a game again. So let's make a website. So first thing to do is I'm going to look at my HTML page. Websites don't use canvases, at least not much. I'm going to get rid of it. Instead, I'm going to use a div which I need to pass in my div. So I need to pass this in here. To pass in the div, and I need to pass it in here, just so I'm just telling my SBT plugin that now when you reload, please use this snippet of code to reload the page. If you don't use the SBT plugin, it's also fine. You just need to press Command R manually, so it's not a huge loss. So I'm now passing in the div, and if you look at my console, nothing's happening. So first, since I'm passing a div, I want to change this to a HTML div element. You can see I can autocomplete the div element. And once I tell IntelliJ, hey, it's a HTML div element, IntelliJ says, hey, all this stuff you're doing down here is all totally wrong, because you can't get the rendering context on the HTML div element, and you can't do stuff to a rendering context that you couldn't have gotten. So that's okay for now. Since I'm changing this, I'm going to get rid of all the stuff IntelliJ complains about. That's the best way to make your code type check. And I'm going to say, hello, world. And now it's compiling. As I said, the first time is slow because compiler is slow. It will speed up in a moment. And now we print line, hello, world, to the browser console down here. So print lines go to the console. I can say, what should I do next? I'm going to rename this from canvas to container because it's not actually a canvas anymore. I'm going to say inner HTML equals H1, hello world. I can't type because it's cold outside. It's like 0 degrees. The road was covered in ice this morning. So now when I change this, I have hell world. Okay, so that's a basic first approximation of how you work with Scala.js. All JavaScript APIs are available. You can use dom.alert. You can use dom.console.log, which behaves similarly to println. As you can see, you get, because of the library I included earlier, Scala.js DOM, basically everything in the DOM has been typed. We have gone through and copied all the types from Mozilla's documentation, and they're now all available in the editor, which is very nice. So, however, I don't want to make a website by using string concatenation, because that is fragile, that's verbose, and that is makes your site open to cross-site scripting vulnerabilities. So instead, I'm going to use a library which I made called Scala Tags. So I don't know if any of you have used it. Scala Tags is a small HTML generation library that runs on both JVM and Scala.js. So it's a cross-platform Scala library, one of a number of them. So I'm just going to copy and paste this in. I need to restart SBT because I changed the config. IntelliJ is going to have to reload. IntelliJ and SBT like fighting over my IV cache. That's unfortunate. Container. So instead of setting that to hello world, I'm going to just clear it. I'm going to say container.append child. So this is a normal JavaScript append child method. And I'm going to need to render a fragment using Scala tags. So I can say Scala tags dot the JavaScript DOM version dot I want everything. Here, I'm now going to say I want to render a div whose contents is a H1, not he, H1, hello world, and a paragraph saying, I am cow. So the IDE and SBT, and not just the SBT, but also my browser is complaining at me because it's expecting a node and then giving back a typed tag. So this is just an unrendered fragment, and I need to call render on it for it to be happy. So la la la, and then it finishes compiling. I have hello world, I am cow. There we go. So it's slightly ugly right now. Let's grab some Bootstrap because that's how you make websites slightly less ugly than they already are. Download, I don't download it. CDN, here we go. I get Bootstrap from the CDN. This is again a normal Scala HTML application. It's nothing special here. I think let's make it XHTML. And then now when I refresh the page, it should be Bootstrappy and hip. So now it's bootstrappy. Let's try making it take some input. So one thing that HTML pages, interactive web pages do is that they are interactive. So I'm going to put in an input element. So all these elements are nicely type checked and given by the Scala tags library. So I have an input, I can type stuff in, nothing happens because the input doesn't do anything yet. So to make the input do something, I would need to render the input to a variable, put the variable in here, put the rendered input in the fragment, and now I have an element of type HTML input element. So this is exactly what you can do in JavaScript, except it's much less verbose. You don't need to call document.createElement by tag and put the tag name. It's also much more type safe. So now it knows I have a HTML input element. I can easily do things like get the value of the HTML input element and dot set the on key up, for example, equals event handler, which looks like that. With Scala 2.12, this will disappear because it'll be inferred as a single assignment method interface. For now, we have to use it still. And let's just print this out. So, refresh. You can see it's printing out the stuff I type in here. Let's do something more interesting. Let's have an output element and put the stuff in the output element. So it's quite cute. You can see if I try to say output.value, it complains because it knows that output is a div and it knows that input is a HTML input. So type safety is great. I'm going to put this output element below the input element. I'm going to say output.textContent is equal to the value of my input. Okay, this needs to be here for the compiler to be happy. And so here's a small interactive web page that does not much, but kind of shows you how working with Scala.js works. So next, let's make it more interesting. Let's turn it into autocomplete widget, because at Dropbox, we are spending several weeks writing a new autocomplete widget because it's very difficult in CoffeeScript. So let's say I have a bunch of things to autocomplete. Apple, banana, mangosteen, mandarin. Let's give some similar things for it to be interesting. So now instead of just rendering the input, I want to render a list of things. So let's say I'm going to clear the insides. And I think it's in a HTML to clear it. And output.append child, so again, this is a normal JavaScript API, an unordered list, which contain, I need to render it. And I need for fruit in fruits, yield a list item with the fruit in it. So this will just render everything every time, I think. So, and everything every time, not interesting. So I can change this and make it if fruit.starts with my input.value. So to upper, let's make it uppercase. Sorry, it's kind of running off the left side of the screen, but you guys will have to see it. So if it matches, I will render it. Apple. Nope, that didn't do it. To lowercase. There we go. So now when we see this happening, I can type apple, mangosteen, so mandarin. So kind of cute. Let's say I want to highlight it. I can take the fruit. What do I want to do now? I want to take the fruit and split it into first and last parts of the fruit. Fruit.split, I think there's a split at method. My input.value.length. So let's put this in the next line so you guys can see. So I'm going to make a HTML span first with background color yellow. So this is all my Scala tags templating library at work. And I'm just going to put the last as unformatted text. So now I have an autocomplete widget which highlights stuff. So this is quite cute considering how little effort I've put into this. It has been about 20 minutes since I started coding, and I have an autocomplete widget that runs locally. So what else do you do with HTML pages? One thing you do with HTML pages is you don't just run them locally. They tend to make requests to some web server on the internet somewhere. So I'm going to show you that now. So the API we're going to use is called Open Weather Map. So Open Weather Map tells you the weather. For example, it tells you that in Zhuhai in China, it is 32°C, which is kind of hot. What's interesting is that they have an API, which lets you get this stuff for free. So for example, I can show that I think there's a search functionality which kind of matches what we want to do with searching for fruits. So here's the weather in London as XML. If I don't want XML, I accept JSON. I can turn London into LON and they will search for any cities starting from LON. There are many more. So let's just copy this query into my web page. And let's say query equals that. Let's split it into multiple lines so it's not so ugly. Val. And so the way you make a AJAX call in JavaScript, the same way you make an AJAX call, the way you make an AJAX call in Scala.js is the same you make an AJAX call in JavaScript. Val xhr equals new dom.xml http request xhr.open get xhr.onload equals, same, I need to do this kind of annoying event handler. This will go away with next version of Scala. Why is it complaining? Oh, because I need to pass in the URL parameter. So when you pass in query, print line xhr.response text go. So let's go back to our example application. It should be making an AJAX call. Oops, I did it wrong. In JavaScript, you need to say xhr.send. And when that finishes loading, you can see the compiler is now warmed up. Now I have the now it's good. Now it's pretty quick. And now I have the blob in the browser. So let's format it. In JavaScript, you can format things by parsing and unparsing them. So at least you can format JSON by parsing and unparsing it. So let's parse it and js.json.stringify. And I need to pass in some sort of space param. So you see, these are the statically typed facades we're using for the JavaScript APIs. If you want, you can use them dynamically, but if you spend the time to specify what the types and objects are called and what the methods are called, you can use them with autocomplete and in-editor highlighting and all the other nice things. For example, with Scala.js, you have named parameters, which you still don't have in JavaScript. What's wrong? Blah, blah, blah. Space, it is singular. There we go. So now you can see this is the result of the AJAX call you made to the server. Let me scroll up to show you the top of it. So it is a JSON object with some values here. It has a list value, kind of small, but it has a list field which contains a list of the data from each city, like the ID, the name, coordinates, lat long, temperature, all that stuff. So let's try to get some useful information out of this. So instead of just stringifying it, well, let's get rid of all this thing. I'm going to store the parsed JSON as data. I'm going to say data.list.map. So each item for now is js.dynamic. So the data variable is a bit hard to see here, but it's dynamic, which means that it will not get type checked, call whatever you want. If you screw it up at runtime, it'll blow up. But it also makes it convenient for dealing with things like JSON from a web server, which you haven't bothered writing facades for. So I want a tuple of item dot, let's say it's name. I think it's item.main.temp, which is this fellow down here. And let's get item.sys.country. So I know I need to get a country because the same city is often in multiple countries. Like there are a million San Franciscos in every Spanish-speaking country in the world. And so now it's a dynamic object, which means we can't really do much with it yet. But if we cast it to a typed object, for example, I'm casting it to a tuple of string, double, and string, we can then use it, and let's convert it to a normal sequence. We can then do things with it. So val items equals that, items dot, now it's normal sequence, I can call for each and just like print stuff out. So this is casting like any other casting. It's all up to you. If you screw it up, it'll blow up at runtime, completely not checked. But after you finish casting it and we're down here, you're back into typed land again. And if we screw up, for example, for each here, the compiler will complain. So let's go back down to the output. So here is a list of tuples of the data we extracted from the JSON blob. So let's make good use of this. Let's take this query and let's chuck it into the onKeyUp handler. So here I'm going to make the query. Instead of appending immediately on the onKeyUp, I'm going to append after the results have come back from the server. Instead of using fruits, I'm going to use items. So I guess I can get rid of these fruits for now. And so now it's complaining. I can't call to lowercase on a tuple. Let's break it up into name, temperature, and country. So if name.toLowercase starts with that, this is name. So after the name, we are going to put in comma temperature. Let's say comma country dash temperature. I don't want the string, I want the variable. So this is constructing an HTML fragment, and now when I type stuff in, I get a lot of Londons, which probably means I need to make the query smarter. Instead of hard coding LUN, I'm going to soft code my input.value. And I think I need to move the clearing into the onload to make sure I don't get duplicates like I have here. So now when I type stuff in, I can say, what's the weather in London like? It's in Kelvins, which is not very helpful. So Kelvins to Celsius. Let's convert it to Celsius. For you guys who like Fahrenheit, you can convert it to Fahrenheit too. So now let's do London. Let's make it integer because the floating point rounding errors make it super ugly. Sorry? So London, there we go. So London, California is 1 degrees. London, Great Britain is 9 degrees. Portland, Oregon is minimum. The lowest weather station is 2 degrees, it looks like. Singapore, where I'm from, is pretty warm at 26. San Francisco, where I now work, there are a bunch of San Franciscos, but the one in the United States is 18 degrees C. So it's been 27 minutes, and I have a little working autocomplete for you that uses a remote server. So this is kind of how you get started using Scala.js. You download the example app. I don't see any of you downloading it, but whatever, you can try it later. And you start hacking around with it to make your application work. So you can do anything you can do in JavaScript. You get types, which is very nice. You can not use types. So over here, for example, I'm using dynamic. And if I screw up, for example, a call to map, I call it map instead of map, it should blow up at runtime. There you go, can't call map of undefined. So if you're gonna fall back to dynamic, it's up to you. If you screw up, it'll blow up, but it's convenient in many cases. In the vast majority of the program, it's statically typed, which means that I get IDE support, autocomplete, jump to definition, all the other nice things that you expect from a modern programming environment. So let's go back to slides a moment. What are the takeaways from this part? Well, one is that Scala.js works. You can make something, you can debug it, you get all the nice compilation errors in the browser, you can see it misbehaving and fix it. You can publish it. So this application is now, the one I showed you earlier was 140 kilobytes published, fully optimized. Let's fully optimize this one. Full op.js. HTML generation using Scala tags is quite nice, and it's much safer and much more concise than most other templating languages, and also much more convenient to use. There's no like files lying around with special template format. You just generate stuff in your source code and splat it wherever you want. And lastly, working with a DOM is much easier with types. So I did not use, my full opt was wrong. Let's fix that first. So I didn't use jQuery or any fancy libraries to work with a DOM. I just used DOM methods. And the thing is, DOM methods, even though they're confusing, they're hard to remember, it doesn't matter how hard to remember something is if you have a complete list of everything you can do dropping down in the editor in front of you. Like, there's no special abstractions here I've come up with. It's totally bog standard DOM APIs. But with types, using it directly is actually reasonable. So my asynchronous thing has finished. Let's look at how big the output fully optimized binary is. For this application, it is 143 kilobytes. So again, it's not huge, it's reasonable, it's not tiny, it's mostly the standard library. And it's about the same size as you would be happy to deploy. Yes?
Can you do like a CDN for the standard library and
The way it's set up now, you cannot use a CDN for the standard library. So the reason you can't do it is because what we are doing in Scala.js is we are doing a full program optimization. So before we did whole program optimization, the standard library would take up 20 megabytes of JavaScript. So Chrome would like slow to a crawl trying to load in this massive blob. And that's how big it is if you load the whole thing. What Sebastian has done is he has set it up such that any unreachable code will be eliminated, similar to what ProGuard does on the JVM, except it runs much faster than ProGuard on the order of 1 to 2 seconds. But so this makes it down to about 800 kilobytes a megabyte. And when it fully gets crunched down, it gets crunched down to about 100 to 300 kilobytes, but it means that each of these whole program optimized blobs cannot share code with other whole program optimized blobs. So if you have two Scala.js applications, both of them optimized, they're going to have two several hundred kilobyte blobs sitting on your web page. Maybe it's okay. So I work at Dropbox.com, and Dropbox.com downloads about 2 megabytes of JavaScript. So maybe 100 kilobytes isn't such a big deal after all. The email said that I was meant to give a break after the first 40 minutes. Is that still a thing? So I guess not. So I guess I can take questions for now since you guys, yeah?
I have a question on the Scala tags. Can you decorate the elements with like classes and stuff? If you were going to use
Yeah, you can. Bootstrap. So I don't remember the bootstrap syntax for doing things now, but let's say I want to... Let's say I take my span, which my list item, and say class. Well, I can say class here equals my class, but I've given it a shorthand because class is a special name that you use a lot, so I just make it class. I prefer to class with a K because class with a K is kind of annoying. And now if you reload the page and I fill stuff in, I believe the class should turn up. Sorry. Nope, the class didn't turn up. I don't know what I did wrong. But yes, you should be able to use classes.
Okay.
Yes?
What about calling some libraries? You know, the language is important to have access to libraries.
Okay. So the answer is yes, and you have two options. One is you do it dynamically. So similarly to what I did with my JSON blob, you can just say js.global. Whatever you want, and it won't type check it, and it'll just be compiled straight to JavaScript, and it hopefully will work. The other way is to do it statically. So similarly to what we did with js.json and dom.xml HTTP request, we went and wrote out a spec for what the library API is, and you work against that interface. So the DOM library is not a special library. There are several other libraries. If you go to scala.js.org, you will see that we have the DOM, we have jQuery, we have Scala.js React by David Barry. We have, so what other of these are JavaScript libraries? We have Scala.js Angular by Xavier. So it's not a huge selection. And if you always want to, you can fall back to doing things dynamically. Just by using js.dynamic. But my experience has been that it's always better to write static types because then you get confused once at the interface rather than getting confused everywhere within your program. So I've used Scala.js React a bit. I've not used Scala.js Angular, but this guy is basing his startup on it, so I guess it works. Yes?
Yep.
Yeah.
Do you know whether that difference is, like, where do you think that difference is going to be 5 years from now? Is that just we're getting started and there's still bugs, there's still open work to be done, or is it just?
I don't know how much better we can make the optimizer. The root cause of this bloat is that the standard library contains a huge amount of stuff, and all the stuff is heavily entangled together. So we already do some pretty amazing things, like in Scala.js, you get inline for loops for free, and even given all that optimization, it still is about this size. So I'm not sure whether we'll be able to make it as small as pure script at like a 20 megabyte blob, simply because of Scala collections. Any collection you use, any option, any sequence, any for loop, tends to pull in all the other collections and include them in your executable. So, I don't think anyone's working on doing that right now. Yeah, like no one on the Scala team, as far as I know. So, question?
What's left for 1.0?
What's left for 1.0? Let's take a look. What's left for 1.0? Scala.js/Scala.js. Issues. Milestones. So next is 0.6, which is basically a pre-release 1.0. A lot of edge cases. So things like this would improve performance. Things like this aren't really implemented properly right now. Things like this would improve performance. This is for future compatibility when Scala uses JVM default methods. And Scala.js will take advantage. There's a lot of polish. So most of the hardcore work has already been done. Let's look at, so that was what, 0.6. 1.0, nothing planned yet. But basically, most things are already there. There's a whole bunch of polished things. For example, object.hashCode by default returns 42. Because we didn't need it for up to now, and we just hard-coded it, and now we fixed it. And the whole bunch of other small things around edge cases. Java.io.printwriter was not implemented. So now they're going and implementing Java.io.printwriter and making it work, which is surprisingly difficult, but that's what we're doing, just to make sure we cover a very broad base of things you can use. Yes? So I have a few, and there are more which I can't show you because there are some person's company using it. That's not me. So let's look at some examples. So this fellow is about a 2,000 lines of Scala, 1.5K lines of XML online video game where you can like, draw things around and roll around. The goal of this game is to kind of get to the right side of the screen. So let's see if I can do that. So this kind of shows you the kind of stuff Scala.js can do. It's not just for making small hello worlds. This is actually quite a large amount of code and XML and other things. It interops with a third-party JavaScript physics engine, which kind of answers your question, how well can you interrupt with physics? So this game uses chipmunk.js, which is a JavaScript physics library here, not written by me. If you go to the source code of the game, /LiHaoyi/role, you'll see that it's not a huge amount of Scala files, but it's a good amount of Scala files. And so for example, here are the static types I use to interrupt with Chipmunk in a type-safe manner. I could easily use a non-type-safe manner, but this works. As for bigger than that, I don't have any I can show you. One guy's writing his trading platform, one guy's writing a startup in Korea. There are a few people like scattered around the world using it for real work. I write CoffeeScript for money, so I don't actually use it for real work.
I love how you mistake HS instead of JS.
Yeah.
The question is, what if you are supposed to do some unpermitted stuff, like forking threads, working with files, whatever, making requests to the different domains. So what would happen?
It would blow up with not implemented error. Let's do that now. Thread. Like that, right? What happens if I try thread.sleep? I can't do that in JavaScript. The answer is It will give me a warning at build time. No, thread.cp is not defined, and it should blow up at runtime. You have to you need the source code to translate to JavaScript, so that's a limitation. Any library you need needs to be pre-translated to JavaScript first, and usually in the process of pre-translating, that's when you find all the bits and pieces which you can't use. So I'll go into that more in a moment.
Okay.
So let's go back to the slides for now, because this is exactly what you were asking. So the next bit is about making cross-platform libraries. How convenient? Yes.
You mentioned source maps earlier.
Yeah. We have them. I haven't set them up for this demo. If it throws an exception in the browser, it'll give you the Scala files and the Scala line numbers. Still not perfect, but work in progress.
Yeah, like it was good enough that in Autodesk Fusion, I got Scala debugging inside Fusion 360.
So cross-platform libraries. So one reason you make a cross-platform library is because you can. So Scala tags started out as a JVM library because Scala.js did not exist in 2012. It munges strings and spits up the strings as a blob of HTML. There's no reason that this must be JVM specific, and it's not. So if you look at this nice picture I pulled from Maven Central, everyone up here is using Scala tags on Scala.js, and everyone down here is using Scala tags on Scala JVM. It's about 1,000 plus downloads a month on Maven Central, so it's not a huge project, but it's not just me who's using it. There are other people out there who are also using it. And it kind of proves the point that, like, if you can cross-compile it, why not? It will allow your code to be used by more people, which is always nice. Apart from Scala tags, you have a good number of libraries cross-compiled. This is a small selection. If you go to the website, scala.js.org, you will see more. So Scala tags, it's HTML generation. We have unit testing. We have serialization. We have change propagation. The left side is some ones I made. The right side is existing libraries that our community has taken and cross-compiled without asking permission. So we have Scala Z on Scala.js, we have Shapeless on Scala.js, Monocle, Parboil 2, all work on Scala.js. Again, we had to cross-compile them using the source code. We can't just take in the existing jar and use in a Scala.js project. But we have people maintaining forks, which basically add two lines of configuration for each of these projects. So if your Scala project really truly does not use any JVM-specific dependencies, then this is what it takes to cross-compile it to Scala.js. This is what David Barry used to cross-compile Scala.z. Mind you, Scala.z is a huge library. The jar file for Scala.z is 50% larger than the jar file for the standard library. So it's this huge thing, but it does not use any JVM-specific functionality. So we just cross-compile it for free, almost. So this also is interesting because it puts to rest the common thought that, oh, there's no point cross-compiling to JavaScript because you're going to have to know JavaScript anyway. Well, this is clearly false because Tony Morris and Lars Hoople, who wrote and maintained Scala.z, did not know about Scala.js and were not thinking about cross-compiling for JavaScript. Similarly, Miles Sabin, who's the guy who wrote Shapeless, also was not thinking about Scala.js. We just took their code from GitHub, added a bit of config, and cross-compiled it. And now people can run Scala.z in the browser just because you can. Some of you may be wondering, so I said, if you don't use any JVM-specific functionality, so here's a short list of can users and can't users in Scala.js. In short, Reflection, operating system, threads, Java, like Java, not Scala, but Java source code, networking stuff, Java tools, can't use. So this rules out things like Spray, Scala test, Akka, Scala pickling. All these use these not supported APIs. Things you can use. Most of java.lang, which is very basic, has been ported. Almost all of Scala has been ported, except for things like the parallel collections. Macros work in Scala.js, Scala async. My Upickle, the serialization library, heavily uses macros as a replacement for Reflection, which is often a trend. If you give up using Reflection, you often can use macros to accomplish the same functionality. You can use all the DOM APIs, like I already showed you, using XML, HTTP requests, and all that stuff. So here's a short list. Actually, cross-compiling things is an ongoing effort. Yes?
At what point do you find out you can't use them? How does that manifest itself?
It manifests itself in an error in the compilation, and it does not compile.
Okay.
Okay, so if I had a library that had some features that were maybe usable in a browser,
yeah,
but a few that weren't.
As long as the things which were not usable in the browser do not get called transitively by any entry point of your Scala.js program,
okay,
it will be okay. So, for example, the Scala standard library has a number of things that do not work, and I did not call parallel collections, and so it's happy. If I did call it, it wouldn't blow up. It would give an error saying that nope, doesn't work. Yeah. Anything else?
With web workers, it work.
What? What?
With web workers, it could work.
Yeah, with web workers, it could work. I think there's one guy from TypeSafe who's exploring Arca on Scala.js using web workers. I have my doubts whether that will work, but it's entirely possible. So, okay, so now for some live coding. So I'm going to use the project github.com/lihaoyi/utest-example-module. And this is going to be an example application which cross-compiles, example library which cross-compiles to Scala.js and Scala.jvm. So let's open that up now. I've downloaded it earlier. This window, let's kill this, and let's go back to utest example app, SBT. Let's run it on a unit testing loop. So if you open up this library, we'll see it has a JS subproject, it has a JVM subproject. Each of these subprojects has a source folder. Each of these subprojects has a shared folder. The shared folder in JVM is simply symlinked to the shared folder in Scala.js. So the shared folders are always guaranteed to be the same contents. If you look at the build files, just because that's interesting, instead of the Workbench plugin, which was designed for interactive web applications, we have the utest JavaScript plugin, which is meant for unit testing libraries on both platforms, and the same old Scala.js plugin. Here, you can see that this is basically what the utest.js plugin gives us, a convenient syntax for defining a library with some shared settings over here, some JS-specific settings here, and some JVM-specific settings here. So now that's set up, you see that I've run unit tests, and it runs twice. It runs once on Scala.js and once on Scala.jvm. So this library is more a proof of concept than anything useful. It does a small number of things. So functionality number one, it lets you square numbers. Just in case you didn't know how to, you can include this demo module, it'll let you square numbers. Functionality number two, it lets you eval JavaScript strings. Why not? Functionality number three, it lets you ask, who am I running on? On Scala.js, it says Scala.js. On Scala.jvm, let's open this a bit bigger. On Scala.jvm, it will say Scala.jvm. So here. So what's interesting about this library? One is that lots of functionality which lives in a shared folder is written once, and if I change it here, it's guaranteed to stay in sync. It will not diverge because it's symlinked. Two is that functionality that differs between platforms can be written separately. For example, this is implementation of eval.js in JavaScript. JavaScript has an eval method, because that's what you do in JavaScript, eval strings. This is the eval method in Scala.jvm. It uses Rhino. Some of you may have spotted it in the earlier build file. And Rhino requires a bit more boilerplate to eval the JavaScript string, but in the end, it evals it. And things, so eval should behave identically in both contexts. And if you wish to, you can include code which behaves differently depending on what platform it's running on. For example, who am I returns different things. So that's the library code. Let's look at the unit test code. So I can have shared libraries code. I can also have shared unit tests. So here's a shared unit test that tests our square method, because you never know when you'll screw up the implementation of multiplying two numbers. And you can see it does some asserts. It works. If you go over here, you can see it's happy. Over here is implementation of our eval.js method. Now, this is interesting because this lives in the shared folder, but implementations it's testing are implemented separately on each platform. So just because your code is implemented differently doesn't mean you can't test it once. And this is what Scala.js lets you do. Of course, it's up to you to make sure that the two implementations match. So if I go to, for example, Scala on the JVM, and I screw this up somehow, blah, null, we'll see recompile, and we'll see one of the test cases pass and the other fail. So Scala on the JVM blew up. Scala on JS worked. So it's up to you to make sure it matches. But if it matches, that's great. You don't need to worry about it. The unit test can be shared. Lastly, Apart from shared unit tests, you can also have separate unit tests for each individual platform. For example, I have one unit test that makes sure who am I returns Scala JVM on Scala JVM, and I have another unit test which makes sure who am I returns Scala.js on Scala.js. So if it behaves differently, test it differently, it's fine. So U-test is convenient in that it lets you have each test have a returned method, which is just stringified, just so you can see it in test results as a sanity check visually to make sure it's doing what you expect. So I'm going to make it return who am I on each of these tests. And when you run, when it finishes running, you can see the first set of tests ran Scala JVM, the second set of tests ran Scala JS, which is what you'd expect. Lastly, you can do things like, if I go to my shared code and I try to do something bad like that, because I can't sleep on Scala JS, but it should work on Scala JVM, it blows up on Scala JS and it works on Scala JVM. So this is more or less how working with cross-platform libraries feels like in Scala.js. To go back to the slides, these cross-platform libraries actually work. We have maybe a dozen of them right now. Not a lot, but a good number. Code that works on both platforms can be shared, even unit tests. Code that's specific to each platform can be provided separately, again, even unit tests. Shared code can test non-shared functionality. And overall, it actually kind of makes sense. Whatever you want to be shared, you chuck it in a shared folder. Whatever you want to provide separately, you chuck it in the relevant source folders in JS and JVM, and it works. So if I wanted to publish this thing locally, I could SBT publish local. So by default, SBT will run it on both sub-projects. That's just what SBT does. And if I look at .home.iv2, .local, I think it's under com.li Haoyi. You'll see that there is a demo module version Scala 2.10 and a demo module version Scala JS 0.5 version Scala 2.10. So cross-publishing libraries works. So that's it for libraries. So the last thing I'm going to talk about today is client-server integration. So this has long been the so-called holy grail of web development, where if only I did need to write all my algorithms twice in two different languages with completely different semantics, and like constantly be serializing and deserializing data back and forth, web development would, in theory, be much easier. So for the example I'm going to use today, it's going to be spray template. So this is not code that I wrote. This is code that Johannes, Rudolf, and Matthias wrote. These are the spray guys. I have no hand in this. So if I go, I've checked this out earlier, and let's go to my spray template and let's open it up in IntelliJ. Spray template, here we go, this window. So these guys have set it up such that I can easily start a spray server and we'll see it take effect. This is a pretty straightforward template. So let's look at the build files first. It includes this SBT Revolver project, a plugin which is all it does is let you auto-reload the server when code changes. It contains a bunch of dependencies which are basically Akka and Spray, so not surprising for a Spray template. It contains unit tests, which I will ignore for now, and it contains configuration and some source code. So it contains an app which sets up stuff, and it contains a small server which runs with a route which lives here. So if I go to the browser, so I believe this connected to 8080. So if I go to the browser, host 8080, say hello to spray routing and spray can, blah. So if I change it, it reloads automatically, if I'm not mistaken. Come on, and it doesn't reload the browser, but I can reload it myself and it'll update. So this is a spray application. Let's make it work with Scala.js. So I already made a small Scala.js project earlier, so let's open that up again. Workbench example app. I'm going to open this in a new window this time, so we can look at both of them at the same time. So over here we have Scala.js, and over here we have Spray. How do we integrate Scala.js and Spray? So the most straightforward way is to create a sub-project in your Spray app program. So let's call it client. I think SBT needs you to do like val client equals project dot in file client, otherwise it won't be happy. And then integrating the two is basically a matter of taking the source code from this fellow and chucking it over here. And yes, I don't know what I'm doing, but I'm pressing OK. Taking the build SBT file, also chucking it in there. And yes, add it to Git, thank you. And I guess taking the project, the plugins, and merging them. So OK, so now I have a Spray Scala.js project, kind of. So if I run client/fast-op.js in this Spray project, it should then compile our Scala.js application. So let's take a look at that. So waiting for lock is fighting with my editor. Editor's done. And in a few moments, we should see it turn up under this folder. OK, so it didn't. Why didn't it turn up? Oh, because non-existent method refused to compile. Let's get rid of that. Where did I put it? Where's my thread? Thread. Here it is. Kill it. OK, try again. Compile. So again, Scala compiler is kind of slow. In practice for interactive development, when the JVM is hot, the compiler is a lot faster and it's incremental, so it's a lot faster. So now if I look, I have example fast-op.js, which is the same file that we saw earlier. So the question is, how can I take this example fast-op.js from my client project and chuck it into my server project? So one thing that SBT lets you do is that it lets you wire things up differently depending on how you configure it. So for example, my IntelliJ seems to have frozen. Not sure what it's doing. Give it a moment. So the idea is you take the output of the fast stop build step and put it in the resource directory of the Spray server. So you do this by saying resources in compile plus equals fast-op.js in client compile. So this is a weird magic incantation, like most of SBT. So if you think it's confusing, that's okay, because I also think it's very confusing. But this is how you wire up things with SBT. And then it's going to complain, because I need to import, import the fast-op.js task. So Scala.js plugin.keys.all. So now if I run SBT re-start, we should see that it will turn up in the resource folder of the Spray project and should update automatically because of this dependency that gets added here. So these are all available online. Don't worry about memorizing it. All three examples are on the internet, on GitHub. So now if I look at my Spray folder, you see I now have my example fast-op.js. I haven't bothered copying over the source map. Whatever, we'll skip that for now. If you want to, you can, and the error messages will be better. But so if I go to my Spray server and I go to fast-op.js, it doesn't work. And when you look at why it doesn't work, this server is so simple it doesn't even serve static resources, which maybe is what you want. So let's make it serve some static resources. Let's say that this HTML page is only served for a single slash. I think it's like path single slash. This is all Spray stuff, nothing Scala.js specific. And let's say that anything else goes to, I think it's a get from resource directory. So this will make it serve from the resources. So after that, recompile. What's it complaining about? Am I missing a curly brace somewhere? I guess I'm... What's wrong? Maybe I'm missing a curly brace. No? Too many curly braces? Yeah, too many curly braces. OK. So let's try that again. So now if I serve this up, it works. So now our Scala.js application is being served from the Spray server. Our Scala.js JavaScript is being served from the Spray server. The application currently is not. And to fix that, I'm just going to take the HTML from here, blah, blah, and take it and chuck it here, because that's how you do it. That's one way of doing it, simply. And fast.js, that's right, save, refresh the page. And now we have our Scala.js application being served from our Spray CAN server. So that was easy. So if you look at what actually matters in this code base, the number of lines of code needed to do this inter-project integration is 4 lines here, 1 line here, the Scala.js plugin, and not this file, 1 line here, and I guess this is a line that's important, making it serve the fastop.js file. So that's kind of what a minimal Scala.js Spray integration looks like. And you can do more things. I'm not going to do it now. You can do a similar thing with Play, with Scalatra, with whatever you want. All you need to do is take the output.js file, whether fast-opt or fully optimized, and chuck it somewhere that your web server can serve. So this is what a minimal Scala.js project integration looks like. Let's look at what I would consider more optimal Scala.js project integration looks like. So I'm going to use an existing branch because git reset hardhead git checkout autowire. Let's git clean too. I'm going to use the existing branch because it's a reasonable amount of setup to get what I would consider good integration, but I believe it's worth it. So let's close that server. Look at what is now our example and run the same thing, re start. So that will start up our server. So this looks similar to the project earlier. We have a client folder which contains the Scala.js things, Scala.js example. I decided instead of having the root project be the Spray server, I would put in a server project. No big deal, no real difference. The configuration, I have a bunch of shared settings. I have a bunch of client-specific settings. I have a bunch of server-specific settings. Interesting. Shared settings include shared libraries. So these are libraries which work on both Scala.js and Scala.jvm. I include them once. They work on both platforms. That's kind of neat. So if I go to localhost 8080 now, I will have a file browser or something like a file browser. So I say target. So it's making AJAX calls to the server to find out what's on the code on the file system, because the browser can't access the file system. And if you look at what's happening in the network tab, it's making these nice RESTful AJAX calls. For example, the last call asked for the path at target Scala classes example and got back a response, which is a nicely formatted JSON string with all these things inside. So when we have not looked at the source code for this application yet, so let's do that now. We have a shared folder like we saw earlier. Client and server each have their own non-shared sources. Client is a Scala.js application similar to what we saw just now. It has a bit of boilerplate up here for doing RPCs. I'll explain that later. Let's move this to one side. Come on, IntelliJ, move it. There we go. On the server, we have a very similar Spray CAN server as we had just now. There's some boilerplate here for doing RPCs again. Here, I've decided to make the HTML of the web page get generated by Scala tags rather than by XML literals, because I can. Scala tags runs on both platforms. So what's interesting is that this list AJAX call, which sends back and forth nicely formatted JSON, is this list method here. And on the client, let me make this smaller, and then we can see the console output. On the client, it corresponds to this list call here. So where's the serialization code? Generated by a macro. Where is the routing code? Generated by a macro. What's the advantage of this? If I screw it up, the compiler will yell at me, my editor will yell at me, everything will be terrible. If I actually do want to change it, for example, I can change it to list, haha, because that's what my boss told me to change it to. The compiler will yell at me because this API trait does not have a list haha method. So I need to change it here too, list haha. And then the compiler can yell at me because this list method does not, or rather, this server object with extends the API trait does not have a list haha method. So I'm going to fix that too. And when all is said and done, it will, and it finishes compiling, it will only compile when the compiler is happy. And now any AJAX calls are to the list haha method, which is a lot less fragile than what I do at work, working with Python and CoffeeScript, where everything's a complete mess and you change things, stuff breaks, you change things, stuff doesn't break, you push it, stuff breaks, you roll back the push. With the Scala.js and Scala.jvm integrated like this, you have static checks not just in the compiler, but also in the editor, where if I mistype something like that, the AJAX call will not go through. If I try to pass in an integer instead of the expected string, the AJAX call will not go through, the compiler will refuse it. Let's say I want to change how it works. Let's say I want to return, instead of returning a string, I'm going to return a case class of strings. So let's say case class file data name is a string, size is a long, let's say string and long. So I'm going to change it to list files, and then it's going to return for f in files if f dot get name dot starts with yield f dot get name f dot length. So this will return return a case class we're talking about. So what is complaining that doesn't match up. So why is it complaining? The API trait expects a sequence of strings, which is this trait. So this needs to be a sequence of file datas. Come on. Oh, this guy needs to be file data too. So I actually can probably just get rid of this fellow because it's inferred automatically. And then on the client, you see it. Give me a moment. Let me figure out what's going on. I think the problem is I need to move the file data because it's used in the API, in the shared folders API trait. I need to move the file data definition to the shared folder. Makes sense, I guess. So what's the last thing it's complaining about? On the client, it's, well, for one, my name is still wrong. I converted it back to list, and now it's called list, haha. So let's convert it back to list. What else? Now it says it's getting a file data, which it doesn't know how to put in the DOM. So I need to put in data.name. Let's put in a dash, data.size, and let's put in bytes. So please work. What's it complaining about now? Is it still complaining? Hope it works. Server code refuses to work. Come on, I thought I changed that. Maybe I was mistaken. For file in files. I'm not constructing a case class. There we go. So, okay, so now it works. And when we refresh a page, we'll see that it works the first time it compiles, which is interesting for AJAX client-server application. When I type things in, that's not the most interesting part. The most interesting part is when I type things in, and you look at the contents of the AJAX calls, I'm now sending nicely formatted JSON back and forth. So, and when you think about it logically, what we have here is you have a client-server API, and in most places, the client-server API lives in some Google Doc or some spreadsheet somewhere. These are the AJAX calls I support. But when you think about it more deeply, what is the client-server interface? The client-server is the interface which is shared between client and server. In Scala, an interface is a trait, and I put the trait in the shared folder, and so my client-server interface actually lives in the code. Like, this name is not special. I could change API to be cow or my client-server interface or whatever else I wanted to. The name is not special. What's special is that because the interface is shared, the compiler can check both the server and the client and make sure it lines up. And if it doesn't line up, the compiler will yell at you. And what's also interesting is that the compiler and IntelliJ don't even know that it's an AJAX call. As far as the compiler and IntelliJ are concerned, these are normal method calls across modules. The macros turn them into AJAX calls. But the compiler can type check them without any extra knowledge of what's going on. It just makes sure the types line up, and the types line up, the Ajax call will be well formed. So what, let's go back to the slides. So that's what I would consider optimal kinds of integration, mostly for safety. The boilerplate is a bit annoying, but it's O1 boilerplate, which can support O(n) different operations, so it doesn't increase as the size of the application grows. Takeaways, wiring into existing projects is pretty trivial. I already showed you a minimal integration. In an optimal configuration, sharing code between client and server is awesome. You have shared constants, shared algorithms. So the serialization for the Ajax calls from sequence of strings and sequence of file data of strings is all handled by the UPickle library, which is a shared Scala.js, Scala.jvm library. So I can guarantee that it will always behave the same way on both sides. The Scala tags library is shared. I need to define my file data case class. Where do I put it? Do I define it twice? No, I put it in a shared folder. I define it once, and it works after that. So this is really nice, and it's something you don't get traditional web development. Type safety, which makes shared code awesome, is also very nice. So if I come here, and I try to do something stupid, like I try to do, on my client, I try to do a new server, or server dot something, it doesn't work. The compiler and even the editor know that the server does not exist in the client, and if you try to do it, it will refuse. And the whole setup actually works. So this wasn't a pre-screen, pre-video demo. I wasn't keyboard syncing to a pre-recorded video. I was actually doing it, and it actually does work. So to wrap up, so Scala.js works. It's usable for all sorts of different projects. You can make games. You can make... Oh, one thing I didn't show you earlier, which is worth showing, is let's go back all the way here. Where were we? Live coding. I didn't show you the ray tracer, which is a cute demo of things you can make using Scala.js. You can make games, you can make visualizations, you can make client-server web interactions, you can make Node.js modules, you can make Chrome plugins. There's a Chrome plugin and a Chrome app store made by one of our community members. The visualization, so this was copied from a Python ray tracer, translated to Scala, and then it worked unchanged in Scala.js. It's about 250 lines of Scala to implement the ray tracer, and I think it's very pretty. It's quite nice. So back to this. So the experience is pretty nice. I already showed you what it's like reloading. The reload time is not terrible. The compilation time is annoying, but okay. The library is kind of bloated, but 100 kilobytes, 200 kilobytes is acceptable. And the future in terms of what we can do is pretty nice. So the number of so-called eternal web development problems that we have managed to solve with Scala.js is actually pretty interesting. So things like shared code between client and server, interesting, not interesting and easy to do to a point of almost not interesting, almost a bit boring, just put in a shared folder, it works. Checked interfaces between client and server. So this is something that we also have. A client-server interface is just an interface in a shared folder, boring and works. Same shared language between client and server. You could use Node.js if you wanted to share the language. I would rather write less JavaScript rather than more. And you get a whole program checked client and server, such that when I change the server to return a file data object instead of a string, the compiler will trace through and check that, oh, here on the client, you're not using it correctly. Here on the client, you think it's a string. Until you fix it, the compiler won't let you run the program, which is probably what you want. And this isn't some hypothetical future case. This is not like you have to wait till Apple, Mozilla, Google, and Microsoft all have to get together and make a perfect internet for everyone. This is something you can use today. It was actually in pretty good shape 6 months ago, but in today it's even better shape. And you can rely on the compiler to deal with a lot of messiness for you, still reaching out to do messy things as necessary, but otherwise staying within the type-safe world. So not everything's perfect. The community's small. I would say there's between 10 and 100 people using this in production. So it's not like we can say that Twitter's been using it for 3 years and it's great. It's still a pretty new project. So the Scala compiler is very slow, and the Scala standard library is bloated. So incremental compilation helps a lot for the compiler slowness, but it's still slow. And the dead code elimination helps a lot for the standard library being bloated from 20 megabytes of rubbish down to 100 kilobytes of what I want. But it's still much more bloated than, say, the Clojure standard library, which compiles to 70 kilobytes of JavaScript without anything fancy at all. We don't have any big corporate backing. It's not the Dart team, which has more people working on the Dart IDE than we have working on the whole Scala.js project. it's just two guys in EPFL and a bunch of extras like me who chip in whenever we can. And there's some rough edges. I think JavaScript has lots of rough edges. In fact, lots of very spiky, painful edges. So maybe it's not too bad, but it's not perfect. And it's definitely a bit less mature than Scala on the JVM. So to wrap up, like while some people are dreaming of the world where this doesn't happen, the people on the Scala.js mailing list have a world where it actually does what you'd expect. So if you guys have experienced web development before and you think it sucks and you think it's stupid and you think that we could do better as 2014, the answer is probably we can do better. In Scala.js land, for many cases, we actually have done better. We fixed a lot of these problems using the compiler and using the type system to help us. And if you want to take advantage of all these things, you can use it today. Cool, so that's it. Thanks. Thank you.